Loss of World War I, the Weimar-era German bourgeoisie was embroiled in political social, and economic catastrophe. They sought to revive the great and everlasting values reflected in their culture's recent past, believing that it would be relatively easy to find their reflected beliefs in music. To the wealthy class, there had not been much outward change in the way that the Weimar Republic consumed and valued music since the war had ended. However, much had shifted in other social and class groups. There was a clear disillusionment of German composers in romantic ideals. In the Weimar era, there lay a distinct split in musical life. Conservative romantics in the wealthy class, often referred to as Wagnerians, versus the anti-romantic, anti-nationalistic, younger, working-class generation. Conservative musicians felt as though they were at a disadvantage in this modern competitive market, but were even more angry at the addition of irony, mockery, atonality, and jazz into the field of serious music. These musicians claimed that an alliance of social democracy and Jewish culture was to blame for these changes. Not the public response to the devastation of the war. The internationalization of music in post-World War I Germany was twisted into a conspiracy, one which alleged that foreign powers aimed to erode the great national identity that was German music. Composer Hans Pfitzner believed that the music of European states was being endangered in two ways. First, by atonal chaos as an artistic parallel to Bolshevism, and second, by the jazz foxtrot blood as the musical expression of Americanism. German conservatives believed that Jews were trying to dismantle Germany by infiltrating their culture and destroying it from the inside. In early 1933, anti-Semitic Nazi policies started seeping into private artistic institutions. After Hitler's ascension to power, there began a massive purge of Jewish influence and workers in the arts. Jews were forced out of their positions and were replaced by Nazi political sympathizers. This purge extended to other undesirables as well, including the Roma, Sinti, non-whites, political dissidents, and gay men. There wasn't a lot of pushback against this initial wave of purges by the German public. Condemnation from powers abroad only strengthened Nazi resolve in this regard. Adolf Hitler decided Nazi musical policy according to his own preferences. Anything that he loved, the public should too, and anything he disliked should be barred from public performance. Official Nazi directives forbade the public performance of Jewish composers and their works in 1933. There was little protest from the public since most artistic agencies at the time were run by Nazi sympathizers. It is possible to divide the tenets of Nazi cultural policy into two ideologies. One is obsessed with preserving German racial purity, as evidenced by the legislative acts and propaganda campaigns of the Nazi government. The other ideology was concerned with upholding reactionary attitudes to modernism in the arts, a philosophy which is much more difficult to impose. Fran, stop air dropping these things. The preservation of racial purity in German arts was paramount in Nazi ideology and had been since its inception. Prominent Nazi educator Hans Schemm proclaimed that, quote, among the entire cultural assets of the German people, German music occupies first place. It is the most German of all of the arts. As the most beautiful and purest and most direct, the German soul finds its expression there, end quote. There's a perceived connection between music and German identity in Nazi philosophy. The second cultural ideology of the Nazi Party was based in reactionary attitudes to modernism in the arts. The Nazis' objection to atonality is that it is a subversive method of musical expression that was cultivated by left-wing composers and a, quote, manifestation of anti-German sentiments, end quote. However, the demonstrated Nazi understanding of atonality is inconsistent in definition and in application. Due to this inconsistency, composers with a varying range of styles, such as Hindemith, Weill, Stravinsky, Schoenberg, and Rutter, were all painted with the same atonal brush. The Nazi Party also held a distinct disdain for internationalism in music. They claimed that native German talent was either succumbing to or being suffocated by foreign influences. Jazz was certainly the most antagonized genre of music under the Nazi regime. Throughout the time of the Weimar Republic, jazz had been consistently condemned by the Nazis as racially degenerate music, and officially banned by broadcasting authorities in 1935. The Nazis objected to jazz because its increase in popularity during the 1920s demonstrated the clearest evidence of foreign influence invading German culture and undermining traditional German values. In the public admonishment of jazz, the Nazis could truly integrate their ideology of racism and aesthetic opposition to modernism. The Nazi Party used pre-existing music as a means of spreading propaganda. They identified pieces which they believed to represent the German voice in music and specifically sought out repertoire that professed Nazi ideals. Music meant a great deal not only to the Nazis, but also to the greater German populace. Due to the adoration of music and its significance as a point of cultural identification, the Nazis supported that using music as a propaganda tool would be highly effective. Music is an integral mechanism of large public ceremonies. It sets the tone of the occasion, reinforcing shared beliefs through subject matter, lyrics, or genre. This sociopolitical mechanism was demonstrated during the Nuremberg rallies held annually by the Nazi Party from 1923 to 1938. The piece you just heard us perform at the commencement of our lecture today is the march from the overture to Richard Wagner's French-style grand opera, Rienzi. This same piece signaled the opening of every Nuremberg rally. This piece held deep cultural and political significance to the Nazi Party, grown out of an adoration from the German public at large. Rienzi tells the story of a young man who wins control of a corrupt government through the sheer force of willpower and belief in a vision for the future, much like Hitler's vision for Germany. When performed at a public political event, this piece evokes a sense of familiarity and pride among those in attendance, associating the event's speakers with nationalism and a sense of comfort. Wagner is one of the most influential composers in history, having written numerous masterworks of the Romantic era. He's also infamous for his virulent anti-Semitism. In 1850, he published an essay entitled Das Judentum in der Musik, or Jewry in Music, in which he stated that Jewish composers lacked creativity and originality, espousing that Jews attempt to steal from or copy German culture and language, though they never quite fully get it, thus leading to poor imitations of Germanic traits. In his eyes, Jews were eternal outsiders, thus resulting in their inability to compose. He believed that Jewish music lacks depth, thus composers such as Mendelssohn and Meyerbeer used tricks to impress the audience, such as mismatching the music and the text to confuse them, though he had no qualms with stealing some of Meyerbeer's compositional conventions in French-style grand opera. In the opera Rienzi, Wagner orchestrates the story of Cola Rienzi, a hero who wrestles and wins control of Rome's government from the corrupt claws of its previous rulers. The nobles, angry at his rule, scheme and plot against him, ultimately murdering him and his sister in the burning of the country's capital. The opera is a bombastic, nationalistic work and allegedly inspired Hitler's vision for Germany's future. Contrary to one's immediate assumption, Hitler did not idolize Wagner for his anti-Semitic tendencies. In fact, Wagner's prejudices were not touched upon in Hitler's personal writings. According to musicologist David Horowitz, Wagner was used by Hitler to legitimize the Third Reich as an organic outgrowth of centuries of German culture and history. Wagner's operas stirred Hitler to envision reuniting the German Empire and restoring it to its greatness. Some historians question the importance of Wagner's music to Hitler, for he's known to be an unreliable historical source. Hitler may have overstated the personal importance he placed on Wagner's music to manipulate the conservative portion of the German people. The bourgeoisie were highly susceptible to Hitler's propagandistic tactics, anti-nationalist Germans less so, as they found Wagner's music and legacy to be tedious. However, I counter that this fact may prove more alarming than Hitler legitimately buying into a false reality of Wagnerian proportions. If Hitler knew the power of Rienzi's story and used Wagner's music to exploit the vulnerability of the bourgeois German public through intentional manipulation of their weakness, I find that to be a much darker, more sinister interpretation than giving into patriotism and delusions of grandeur. In a very brief real way, Wagner's music was propagandized by the Nazi Party. Is it true that Wagner's music contains nationalistic themes? Yes. Is it also true that Wagner himself harbored violently anti-Semitic views? Undoubtedly. Can we, as those looking back on and creating historical narrative, conclusively state that Wagner's music directly influenced the Nazi Party and helped to create their politics? No. Can we still denounce Wagner for his white supremacy and xenophobia? Yes, publicly and often. Wagner's music predated the Nazi Party and was written without Nazi ideology as its source material. Hitler intentionally used the legacy of Wagner and his works to manipulate a vulnerable portion of the German population, thus propagandizing his compositions in the process. In addition to using pre-composed pieces for propagandized purposes, the Nazi Party commissioned the composition of musical works. There are a myriad of compositions that were written on behalf of the Nazi Party. Let me be clear in stating that Nazi songs and compositions are not to be confused with pre-existing music performed during the time of Nazi Germany. Today, the performance of Nazi-specific songs is outlawed in Germany and Austria, resulting in a substantial fine or incarceration for at least 5 years for their performance. There are two major categories of Nazi-written music. The first is Soldatenlied, or soldier songs. These unaccompanied songs were written to keep soldiers in formation and in focus while marching. They keep a steady, clear tempo and sometimes include call and response. They demonstrate a simple tune that even the least musical of soldiers could follow. These Soldatenlied are full of patriotic, propagandized imagery, reinforcing the regime's military and political beliefs. The second category of Nazi music is the official march. These marches were conceived and orchestrated by Nazi composers and performed by German ensembles. Sometimes the accompanying words were even sung by the attending audience. Many of these marches used previously composed melodies, often German folk tunes or communist songs, and then the composers would change the lyrics to fit Nazi purposes. These Soldatenlied and marches are often associated with communal singing, in which all who are present participate in a musical performance, regardless of level of musicianship. This communal singing connection was an effective method of propaganda, leading to positive responses and indoctrination. In an expansion of using music for their own purposes, the Nazi Party propagandized entire genres of music by claiming them to be reflective of racially inferior traits. By June of 1933, the Nazis had managed to oust many degenerate musicians, composers the likes of Schoenberg, Weill, Eisler, and Toch, as well as conductors Otto Klemperer and Hermann Scherchen. They were relieved of their positions and later fled Germany. The time had come to focus on the elimination of musical ideals rather than musical personnel. The Entartete music, or degenerate music exhibit, was a part of a large national music festival called the Reichsmusikstage, or the Reich Music Days, and aimed to clarify what was considered to be musical degeneracy. On May 24, 1938, the Entartete Music Exhibition opened in Düsseldorf. The festival was curated by Hans Severus Ziegler, a musically uneducated Nazi bureaucrat who relied on propaganda tactics rather than personal expertise. Nearly everyone in modern German music was represented at the exhibition. Well-known figures such as Paul Hindemith, Alban Berg, Ernst Toch, Hans Eisler, Ernst Krennic, Arnold Schoenberg, Franz Schrecker, Kurt Weill, and Igor Stravinsky were depicted, as well as German operatic composers Oscar Strauss and Leo Fall. The exhibition began with a lecture given by Ziegler. He cited Wagner's famous essay, Das Judentum der Musik, and followed with specifically stating that this exhibition, quote, should now bring out a clear decision for music as well. What was and is diseased, unhealthy, and highly dangerous in our music, and that for this reason must be eliminated, end quote. He then quoted Hitler's Mein Kampf in justifying this crusade against degeneracy. The main aspect of the Entartete Music Exhibition was a series of photographs or portraits of selected contemporary composers whom Ziegler believed had the most destructive influence on German music. A crude slogan or joke accompanied each photo in the exhibit. Examples of musical degeneracy accompanied the musicians' photos in the form of excerpts of modernist works by the composers. 6 listening booths were set up in the exhibition hall so people could hear examples of these degenerate works. Recordings of pieces by Hindemith, Weill, and Krennic were prominently featured in the audio portion of the exhibit. Kurt Weill was particularly singled out in the listening booths. 2 of his works, Dreigroschen auf Earth and Mahogany, were set up as proof of the Jews' promotion of greed and capitalism, though the works are obviously satirical depictions of modern life. It's important to note that the views expressed in the Entertainment and Music exhibition most closely resembled Ziegler's personal beliefs, not necessarily those of the Nazi Party, particularly regarding Stravinsky. The display was not universally acclaimed by those associated with the Nazis. The exhibit closed prematurely in Dusseldorf on June 14th, but was then sent to Vienna and Munich, and they closed shortly thereafter. There's little evidence of public criticism, most likely due to the exhibit's official appearances and association with the party. Eric Levi puts it so beautifully by stating that, quote, "The degenerate music exhibit, a potential tutorial in recognizing and rooting out destructive musical influences from the new state, consisted merely of haphazard attacks on a hodgepodge of trends and individuals and was full of contradictions," end quote. The visual examples, accompanied by little to no explanation of context in their paired text, rounded out with Ziegler's rambling essay, do next to nothing to define what degenerate music is. The exhibition does not provide any guidelines for artistic practice, nor offers suggestions for future musical policy. It was entirely superficial. The Entertainment and Music exhibition is the most blatant example of Nazi attack on artistic principles, yes. However, early World War II scholars may have overestimated the reach of the exhibition, as well as the reflection of Nazi priorities in its study. It was not as effective as early scholarship believed it to be. Regardless of its lack of historical impact, this exhibition caused many composers to flee Germany, including Hindemith, Krennic, and Weill. Kurt Weill's Dreigroschen Oper, or Little Three Penny Opera, was one of the pieces represented at the Entertainment Music exhibition. We in the wing band world have been lucky enough to benefit from the composer's choice to create a suite of the opera's music for our ensembles. We hope you enjoy our performance of selections from Kurt Weill's Little Three Penny Music.
Thank you.
repertoire consisted primarily of German marches and popular tunes, and the musicians usually had to create their own arrangements due to unusual instrumentation and changing roster numbers. These orchestras had to use the instruments and the musicians available to them, oftentimes resulting in unorthodox ensemble personnel. Though often shackled to their present instrumentation, the musicians would sometimes have access to stolen instruments confiscated from inmates upon arrival. Concerts and performances were officially sanctioned formal events requested by the SS. Upper echelon prisoners could also attend. The camp orchestra was a matter of pride for the SS, and it provided them with entertainment and participation in German culture. Music and musicians were held in such high regard by the Nazis that the imprisoned ensemble members were sometimes able to receive extra food rations because of their performances. Due to what was seen as preferential treatment, some prisoners despised the orchestra members, spitting at them, believing that the performers had it easier than other inmates. Though music was present in the camps to provide perpetrator entertainment, it was more frequently used for punitive purposes. Auschwitz orchestra survivor Simon Lax testified that, quote, "There are many publications that claim, not without certain emphasis, that music kept up the spirits of the emaciated prisoners and gave them the strength to survive. Others assert that music had a directly opposite effect, and that it demoralized the poor wretches and contributed instead to their earlier demise. I personally share the latter opinion," end quote. Music accompanied forced daily routines and work details. The ensembles performed as other prisoners marched to their assigned work duties. This was the primary motive for having musical groups in the camp. Morning and evening would see the most music. It helped create and signify the movement of the daily schedule, often accompanying roll call or appel. In camp, music was often twisted into ironic circumstance and performance, adding to the psychological torment of the prisoners. The Belzec death camp orchestra was forced to perform the cheerful tune, "Everything Passes, Everything Goes By," as new inmates were arriving to the railway platform, and again, as they accompanied the Sonderkommando during their removal of the bodies of those who had just arrived hours before. Musicians were often forced to play cheerful German dances and marches as a backdrop to public beatings and executions. There was a great internal struggle with the juxtaposition of music and horror in the minds of those playing it. It provoked a tremendous amount of guilt, seeing one's art bastardized in such a violent way, to the point that this quandary sometimes led to suicide. Forced singing was a prevalent method of psychological and to some extent physical torture perpetrated by the Nazis in the concentration camp system. Jews were primarily the target of this torture. They were more restricted and sequestered than upper echelon prisoners and could not openly participate in music making unless given express permission by the Nazis. A song would be announced, then prisoners were expected to sing in a precise military fashion. Inmates who did not sing or didn't sing well enough were beaten. If the entire group did not sing well enough, they could be further punished. Allow me to show you an example. The clip you are about to see is of Franz Sugemel, a Nazi guard who worked primarily at the Treblinka death camp. He will demonstrate the song he forced Jewish prisoners to learn and sing at the will of himself and his comrades.
Festen Schritt und tritt und der Blick geradeaus. Immer fest und fest und die Welt geht schau. Marschiere Kommandos zur Arbeit. Für uns gibt's heute nur Treblinka, das unser Schicksal ist. Drum haben wir uns auf Treblinka eingestellt in kurzer Frist. Wir kennen nur das Wort der Kommandanten und nur Gehorsamkeit und Pflicht. Wir wollen weiter, weiter leisten, bis das kleine Glück uns einmal weg. Sind Sie zufrieden? Das ist ein Original, es kann kein Juni heute.
This forced singing and sadistic performance practice constitutes psychological torture. The Nazis demand that the inmates sing frivolous, upbeat German songs and play upbeat marches in a destitute situation caused major cognitive dissonance. This Nazi-enforced derision of musicking is also physical torture. Inmates were subject to hours of forced singing after consuming little food, without adequate sleep, subject to the elements, and after intense physical labor. This was a physical assault on the prisoners' bodies, as well as their spirits and psyches. If my teacher intuition is to be trusted, I believe that we may all need a brain break after that. Let us take a 10-minute intermission, and then we will reconvene to discuss the fire that lights my soul. Music as resistance. Music as resistance. There are three major categories of this topic: the creation of new folk songs within the camp system, new art music compositions within the camp system, and then music post-atrocity. Let us begin with the category of folk songs. In studying the Holocaust, folk songs serve as a significant body of historical text. They document the personal experiences, similar to the way a diary or personal memoirs record events and interpretations. Folk songs are different, however, because they've been preserved through a larger social framework. As opposed to a diary's singular, first-person perspective, folk songs convey the retrospective understanding of an individual, as well as the uncertain, shifting perspective of what the collective community was facing over time. Folk songs capture a specific moment in time. They tell us what people knew or didn't know, and when. They represent a personal interpretation of the narrator, as well as an approximation of factual documentation of the events surrounding the narrator. Individuals and communities use music to make sense of what's happening around them and document their collective experience. Folk songs flourished in the concentration camp system due to their participatory nature. As we've previously discussed, participatory singing is available to all. One does not need instruments or a trained voice to be involved. The folk songs found in the camps were associated with different subgroups of prisoners. These subgroups could be separated by religion, race, nationality, political party, socioeconomic status, sexual orientation, an assigned camp role, or other Nazi categorizations. In general, German political prisoners were given the most privilege, then followed foreign political prisoners. After that came racial minorities like the Roma, the Sinti, or black citizens, and homosexual men. At the bottom of the hierarchy were the Jews, who were intentionally treated the most inhumanely. Due to this social hierarchy, access to music in the camps was unequal. The association of folk songs with different subgroups helps to explain the wide variety of languages and imagery depicted in their texts. Folk songs flourished in the concentration camp system because everyone, regardless of their place in the camp's social ladder, could participate and find camaraderie in some way. There are roughly three manifestations of folk songs in this system. The first is the resurgence of existing folk songs. Prisoners would sing familiar songs that traveled with them from home to the camps. The second is updating the lyrics to existing folk tunes to reflect and record their surroundings. Finally, there was a flood of new folk songs created within the concentration camp system, generally focusing on the themes of political resistance, spiritual resistance, and capturing eyewitness accounts of atrocities. One of the most important functions of folk song compositions during the Holocaust was recording eyewitness accounts of what was happening around people. This scenario is the case for Stille, Stille, or Quiet, Quiet. Stille, Stille is one of the most beloved compositions of the Wilde Ghetto. The song was written during the spring of 1943 as Allied victories led to renewed hope in the ghetto. In response to this hope, there was a flood of artistic creation in Vilna. In April, the camp's literary artistic circle launched a musical composition competition. 11-year-old Alex Volkovisky won with a lullaby melody that he had composed on the piano. A poet in Vilna, Shmerka Kazerjinsky, added Yiddish lyrics to the lullaby and created Stille, Stille. Kazerjinsky was inspired by the story of a woman whose husband was just sent to Ponak, a mass killing site outside of the Vilna ghetto. The song recounts the pain of a mother lying to her child that his father will return, even though she knows that he won't. The lyrics express love for old, peaceful Vilna and shows hope through seeing freedom in the face of the child. The song was first performed at one of the last concerts before the ghetto's liquidation in 1943. Due to the increasingly volatile and intense environment, the original line, quote, "All roads lead to Ponar," unquote, had to be changed to "All roads lead there now." The Council of Jewish Elders feared that a direct reference to Ponar would lead to punishment by the Nazis. However, the audience immediately understood the implication, and the song quickly garnered mass popularity in the ghetto. After the ghetto's liquidation, Alex and his mother were sent to a concentration camp. Amazingly, they are two of the very few Vilna Jews to survive. "Stealer, Stealer" is still a frequently performed song, seen mostly in performances commemorating the murdered Jews of Europe. Importantly, the original lyrics, "All roads lead to Ponar," have been reinstated for modern performances. Here is a clip of Volkovisky's and Kazurjinsky's "Stealer, Stealer."
Text into Czech so that the performers knew the meaning of what they were singing.
A survivor testified that Schechter decreed, quote, "The most important thing is how you feel when you sing," end quote, emphasizing the importance of understanding the meaning behind the lyrics. According to survivor accounts, Schechter was merciless during rehearsals. The performers had to be completely focused on him for two major reasons. The first is that Verdi's Requiem is one of the most musically demanding choral works ever written. It is a long, arduous piece to perform with music in front of its performers. But these prisoners had to rehearse it in a basement, with no octavo in front of them, and without a full orchestra. Second, the Requiem is notorious as an extremely emotional work, though it had an additional level of resonance for these performers. There's the original meaning of the Requiem, remembrance of the dead, praying for salvation, and awaiting judgment. In addition, there is a superimposed meaning now, in defiance of the Nazis. After hearing about the rehearsals for months, the other prisoners wanted to see a performance of the Requiem. Schechter feared that he and his chorus would be transported, so although he was unsure that they were adequately prepared, he led the first performance of the Defiant Requiem with 150 singers and one piano on the night of September 5th, 1943. The next morning, 5,000 inmates were sent to their deaths in Auschwitz. Half of the chorus was taken away in cattle cars. Schechter recruited new musicians and performed the Requiem 15 more times, all without the Nazis in audience. These performances were only for fellow prisoners. Now that the death camps were running at full capacity, massive deception on the part of the Nazis began. They used the artistic facade of Terezin to hide their horrors. The camp got a makeover. The sidewalks were scrubbed, flowers were planted, and fake storefronts were filled with stolen items from the inmates' forfeited luggage. On June 23, 1944, the Nazis brought a delegation from the International Red Cross to Terezin for an inspection. This tour was run by Adolf Eichmann, one of the major organizers of the Holocaust. Everything about this visit was choreographed, down to a soccer game. The Nazis caught the entirety of this visit on a propaganda film entitled Terezin, a documentary film of Jewish resettlement. The Nazis played it off as if all concentration camps were this way, as if they were separating the Jews, not hurting them. The centerpiece of the Red Cross inspection was going to be a performance of the Verdi Requiem. The choir, with only 75 people, was confronted by the realization that they must not perform the Requiem for the Nazis. On one hand, their performance of the Requiem was going to be used as Nazi propaganda and dispatched all over Germany. On the other, the prisoners had the opportunity to sing to the Nazis what they could not sing. Before, these performances had only been for other inmates, and now their hidden message would be exposed to the public. Oh, just as an interesting fact for you, this is the only known photo of Schechter in the chorus. The Dies Irae, the Day of Wrath, that movement is so powerful and it represents a direct threat to the unjust and wicked, as the lyrics describe God's return to earth to judge all for the sins that they have committed. The prisoners would sing to the Nazis, quote, "The Day of Wrath, that day will dissolve the world in ashes, so say David and the Sibyl. How great the terror will be when the judge comes, who will smash everything completely. Whatever is hidden shall be revealed, and nothing shall remain unavenged." If the Nazis came to know the performers' inference of judgment upon their actions, Schechter and the performers would be punished severely. On the evening of June 23, 1944, Schechter and his chorus performed Verdi's Requiem for the International Red Cross with high-ranking Nazi officials in attendance. The performers hoped that the delegation would hear their plea and come to their rescue. However, no help came. The Red Cross delegation went home to Switzerland without intervention or incident. The Red Cross performance was the choir's last. After the delegation left, the transportations resumed. 19,000 people were sent away in 5 weeks. On October 15, 1944, a transport was announced and almost the entire choir was sent to the east. Raphael Schechter's name was also on that list. The next morning, they were packed into cattle cars and were sent to the most famous death camp, Auschwitz-Birkenau. Upon arrival, most of the artists were sent directly to the gas chambers. However, Schechter would go on to survive Auschwitz and three more concentration camps. On March 9, 1945, he died on a death march. 1 month later, liberation came to Czechoslovakia. Though we are unable to comprehend the complex emotions that these prisoners would have felt during their performance of the Verdi Requiem, we can perform a piece of it for you now. Please enjoy the debut performance of my arrangement of Giuseppe Verdi's Dies Irae from his flagship Mesa de Requiem, written on behalf of the Defiant Requiem Foundation.
Thank you.
camp system, there were few musical compositions created within the major camps. Sites such as Auschwitz, Majdanek, or Sobibor saw brutal living conditions, which seriously impeded the inmates' ability to freely compose, not least so because of their limited access to writing materials. In the ghettos, however, one had slightly easier avenues to obtain supplies. Thus, more original musical compositions came out of the ghettos than the camps. The Czech ghetto camp Terezín is famous for its abundance of musical publications. It was not always easy to obtain sheet music in Terezín. Some musicians smuggled pieces into the camps. Others wrote down melodies they had memorized. However, these fragments of musical works were never enough to satisfy the repertory needs of the camp's daily performances. In response to this shortage, camp performers turned to imprisoned composers to create new works to be debuted within the camp. Maestro Murray Sidlin separates the new compositions of Terezín into 9 different content categories: works of censorship, works of longing, works of hope, works of the broken heart, music of the messenger, works of fate, and music in memoriam, pure entertainment, and finally, music as eyewitness. In the interest of time, I have selected one of these categories for further discussion, music of the messenger. Victor Ullmann was a prolific pianist and composer, a compositional pupil of Arnold Schoenberg, and a conducting student of Alexander von Zemlinsky. He was born and baptized as Catholic to converted Jewish parents. Therefore, Victor was considered Jewish by Nazi racial law. He was deported to Terezín from Prague in 1942. Upon his arrival at the camp, he was tasked by the Freizeitgestaltung, or Administration of Free Time Activities, or Leisure Activities, to serve as music critic and concert organizer. He went so far as to form a studio for new music and collegium musicum within the walls of the camp. Ullmann composed 23 musical works while imprisoned in Terezín: 3 piano sonatas, a string quartet, arrangements of Jewish songs for chorus, incidental music for theatrical productions, and a one-act opera entitled Der Kaiser von Atlantis. Sadly, he was deported to and died in Auschwitz in October of 1944. Ullmann composed his 7 piano sonatas between 1936 and 1944. The first 4 were composed while he was freelancing in Prague, and the final 3 while he was imprisoned in Terezín. Sonata number 7 debuted in 1944 in Terezín and was the last written before his deportation to Auschwitz. It was dedicated to his 3 surviving children, Max, Jean, and Felice. Meyer writes that, quote, "It is almost akin to a musical autobiography in which through the 5 movements, he quotes his obvious loves in the shape of quotations and allusions to composers such as Bach, Mahler, Schoenberg, and Wagner. Into this mix, he adds echoes of Slovak hymns, Lutheran chorales, and even a Hebrew folk song in the final movement," end quote. The 5th and final movement of the work is Variations and Fugue on a Hebrew Theme. The fugue includes 3 melodies. The first and main theme is a Hebrew folk tune called Rachel, or Rachel, by Yehuda Sharep. The second is the German Lutheran hymn, Now Thank We All Our God. And the final theme is an ancient Czech Hussite warrior song. According to Murray Sidlin, Rachel represents Ullmann's rediscovery of his Jewish identity, as well as the Jewish people as a whole within this atrocity. The hymn, Now Thank We All Our God, appears sporadically, often menacingly, and represents the Nazis. The Hussite warrior song, also used by Smetana in his work Mavlast, and Karel Huza in music for Prague, represents the strength and pride of the Czech people. When combined, these 3 themes are dissonant and combative, though centered and calmed around the beauty of Rachel. In the fugal war between the Czechs, the Germans, and the Jews, Maestro Sidlin believes that the Jews win, as the melody of Rachel is the last to be heard in the movement. The people of the world struggled to piece together the events of the last 12 years. They began the process of creating a historical narrative, the main purpose of which was to discover the scope of the atrocity of the Shoah. The primary means of this discovery was the collection of first-person accounts of the Holocaust survivors and witnesses. Holocaust survivors struggled with the fact that they had survived the war. They did not know why they are here, why they are alive, and why others are not. Many survivors would not or could not speak about their experiences for years after liberation. Holocaust survivors faced more violence when returning to their homes. The deep-rooted anti-Semitism of Nazi Germany did not disappear overnight. Their homes were occupied by citizens who may have refused to leave. Their communities were completely destroyed. Survivors also faced backlash from the Jewish community, particularly Israel. There was a preconceived notion that Jews who fell victim to the Holocaust went to Auschwitz like sheep to the slaughter. It's important to remember that the Holocaust was an unprecedented human atrocity. There were no social or political rules for how the public was supposed to react, let alone rules and expectations for the artistic response to the atrocity. The world had not seen anything like the Shoah before. After the cultural and historical narrative of World War II and the Holocaust began to form, art began to follow as a response. Contemporary musical scholarship states that music is a subject of historical memory as well as a vehicle for transmitting memory. Therefore, the Holocaust is not only a historical event, but also a larger problem to understand. As an artistic subject, it requires context and insight into the way we created our knowledge about the Holocaust. It's necessary for us to understand how music functioned within the Holocaust, as well as how we came to believe our perceptions about what music did during that time. A major source of generating musical memory regarding the Shoah are Holocaust commemoration ceremonies. It's a hard phrase to say. Music plays an important role in remembrance events, both on behalf of survivors and their families. The repertoire chosen for these ceremonies is an interesting inquiry, as it's often repeated. For example, the Hebrew folk song Ani Ma'amin, or I Believe, is performed at almost every memorial concert. The ceremonial repertoire's thematic emphasis on heroism and resistance is clear. However, what context and nuance are lost in the performance of Ani Ma'amin at commemoration? At the time of their creation, these songs are meant to be uplifting and encouraging. But spiritual resistance is only part of the story. Encouragement is complicated and subjective. In their original context, the performance of these songs in the concentration camps is accompanied by an acknowledgement of pain or hardship, and a feeling that a lot more would come before the end of the war. These songs originally served a purpose of creating togetherness in pain. The repertoire's intent and effect changes when people who did not experience genocide appropriated the songs. The songs are removed from their complicated context, focusing only on resistance. The theme of resistance then dominates public perception of the song and of the people who sang them. Therefore, the song's meaning is simplified within the context of commemoration ceremonies and memorial concerts. Music represents an expansive range of human experiences. By solely focusing on one theme, devoid of context, it is not only doing a disservice to the music in the Holocaust overall and those involved in that music making, but it's also untruthful. It may be a misleading assumption that people had the power to choose whether or not they were morally debased. Acknowledging this fact helps us to honor the richness and complete experiences of victims and survivors. Recognizing their struggle humanizes them further, rather than only seeing them as heroic. Contextualizing their music-making experience helps us see Holocaust victims as humans who were unsure of what was happening to them, not just in the mechanized process of their destruction. There are two prevalent interpretations of musical witness in current scholarship. One argues that musical witness is an important method of cultural memory and empathy. The other questions whether musical witness enacts a sort of aesthetic trauma, and that transferring human suffering into consumable, redemptive, and recognizable human narratives is traumatic, thus inciting violence against those who experienced that trauma in the first place. However, art that puts trauma in the foreground can help people engage with complicated human issues such as suffering, memory, and empathy. Musical witness is a double-edged sword. This genre of music can promote memory, while potentially prompting a certain level of forgetting or erasure. Furthermore, if music associated with the Holocaust is performed only in relation to Holocaust imagery or context, is it ultimately becoming relegated to the ghetto once more? By performing music against the backdrop of Holocaust commemoration, the intrinsic meaning of the music is changed. When music is presented in association with the Holocaust, the audience immediately brings their own set of personal references to the experience, ultimately tainting the performance with their own political, cultural, historical, and artistic preconceptions. Is this undoing all of the good work that we're trying to do in the first place? Holocaust was the first made-for-TV dramatization of the events of the Shoah. It was a 7.5-hour spectacle created by NBC and shown over 4 evenings from April 16th to 19th, 1978. The film depicts the stories of the fictional Weiss family, a German-Jewish family of the bourgeoisie, and their descent from comfort to the gas chambers, and the parallel story of Eric Dorf, an unemployed apolitical lawyer who clandestinely climbs the Nazi ranks. Holocaust is the first major dramatization of the lives and stories of Nazi victims rather than the perpetrators. 120 million people watched the series in the US in its 1978 premiere, and 20 million watched it in Germany when broadcast abroad in 1979. The series sparked an international dialogue about the role everyday people played in the Holocaust. Morton Gould, a Jewish-American composer, created the orchestral score for the film. He rescored the work for band in 1978 and published it as Holocaust Suite. Holocaust Suite is a 6-movement wind band work. Each movement depicts a main theme associated with a character, a place, or event. Interestingly, the final movement, epilogue, elegy, was an addition to the original score that Gould added specifically for the wind band arrangement. According to the composer, it depicts his own preconception of the Holocaust, another form of musical witness. As we perform one final piece for you today, the 6th movement of Holocaust Suite, I ask you to reflect upon what we've discussed this afternoon. I acknowledge that I have raised far more questions than I have answered, both for you and for myself. We will probably never get the answers to these inquiries, but I don't think that means that we shouldn't try. This Thursday, April 28th, is Yom HaShoah, Holocaust Remembrance Day. Please take some time this week to remember, to reflect, and to take action in combating hatred. No act is too small. Thank you, and I hope you enjoy our final performance.
Thank you.
committee members, Dr. Bradley Ethington, Dr. James Tapia, Dr. Elisa Decaney, Dr. Tim Deem, who's doing honor band stuff today. I'd also like to thank Dr. Natalie Draper and Professor Amanda Winkler for their help on this project. Director Milton Lawford as well, he helped me start this research. Dr. Alan Goldberg, who is the Zadie I never had, who's home today and started me on this task. Alexandra Zapruder, who is my colleague at the Defiant Requiem Foundation, she's watching online, thank you. I'd like to especially thank Mrs. Abby Burton for helping me get her father's piece put back in print so we could play more Gould today. Sacrificed a lot of Saturday mornings at 9 a.m. I'm so sorry.